must have time for the last story also. Whole idea is not to go. This is the new thing I wanted to show you. The new thing is from inverter to programmable logic. I told you that in 1.5 hour I must take you through this journey of quickly understanding without detail. Just like we understand a movie, you know, we do not want to understand detail, understand a movie. So, I saw the sixth sense by some what Night Shyamalan, whatever his name is, and in the end I did not know that the fellow was already dead. All my family knew, I did not understand. So, I did not have the sixth sense to understand what happened in the movie. So, it is okay, I also like the movie. So, I did not know who was the murderer, Agatha Christie book. So, I still like the book. So, it is like this. So, even if we do not understand everything, the story is compelling. How it all went from a simple inverter to a VLSI in digital logic with MOS. So, this is the new thing. I think Professor Dinesh Sharma has given you a small dose of MOS transistors. For your information, he and I used to work every day basis for 20 years together. So, he came to IIT much earlier and then I came much later. So, what was the digital logic in VLSI? How did it get there? So, 1959 to 60, first integrated circuit was made in 1960 by Kilby of Texas Instruments and Noyes, who made a linear IC for Fairchild Semiconductor simultaneously but separately. And they both got the patent for this, but only Kilby got the Nobel Prize in 2000 and Noyes did not get. And the simple reason is well known in TIFR. It is not only you have to do good work, great work, but you have to outlast your competition. Outlast meaning you have to be alive. When the Nobel Prize is given, you have to be alive. It is not given posthumously. So, this fellow could not make it. This old man was still alive. When they give a Nobel Prize for making integrated circuit and putting the entire population of earth in a electronics era, bring PC on your tabletop. When we were students, we never even imagined. Thing which required a whole building will ultimately be available with me. Couldn't imagine. Texas Instrument therefore produced the integrated circuits which are digital, and Fairchild and later many other people actually made the MUA 701 of operational amplifier and many other things because of that parallel path. The second part of the story is, though field effect transistor was proposed prior to Nobel Prize winning point contact transistor by Bell Labs, and Shockley was one of them, and Shockley had actually given the full pinch of current equation before they invented this transistor in 1947. So, 1947 is a landmark year. In 1997, they celebrated 50 years of it. So, good things happened in 1947. I was also born in it. Yeah. So, I am following this progress of all integration from transistor onward. I will tell you a little anecdotes from time to time. So, 1968, well beyond 1960, where the first TTLs came up. In 1968, the first successful MOS field effect was done. And poor fellow has never got a Nobel Prize who made that, but it is everywhere. The MOS transistor has won the heart of all people. The greatest thing is self isolation and MOS transistor acting as switches and relays. That is why I think the next few slides will tell you that the transistor characteristic is a figment of imagination. When you have got billions of transistors, nobody looks at the transistor characteristics, but we teach them nevertheless, because they are good for bipolar transistors. They are not required for MOS transistor. So, MOS inverter symbol is the same. If I have got a high input becomes low, low input becomes high. So, we have got this 0 0 like that. So, 0 1 0 1 same symbol. the important property which Texas Instrument did was to assume further, this is not enough. They said if we put two inverters in tandem, then they must do exactly the same. That means the output of one should act as a corresponding input to the other one by definition, right? It is a chain, because if it is an inverter, but if it cannot invert by its own copy, then it is not a good inverter. So this is like kho-kho game, no? Only one player cannot be good, no? Everybody has to be good, otherwise you cannot win the competition. So this is the condition: when something is high, this is low, this takes it as a low and then gives high. So that is the condition. So it must follow instruction. So whatever are the input specifications of a gate must accept the output specification of the same gate, because another gate of the same kind is going to connect to it. So that is the important thing. So what is an inverter? This is an inverter, simply. So the color is there, one black color, one blue color. If I give input A, what happens is this acts like a switch. That switch turns on, and it, that one, for now we do not worry how, but that remains off. So give A high, that switch is off, this switch is on, and this switch connects it, it becomes ground, therefore it becomes low. Exactly opposite will happen. When this A is low, this switch goes off, that switch comes on, then it connects to VDD, becomes high. So we need this important property of these two switches, that when this is high, this gets on, but that goes off, and vice versa. That is called complementary. This is called complement. That is, the two transistor must be complements of each other as far as the switch operation goes. If this is high, this switch is on, this has to be off by definition, and vice versa. So now I have again shown the same thing: one switch is on, that is off, one switch is on, that is off. Therefore, the reason why a CMOS logic works rail to rail, 0 and VDD, TTL does not work like that. TTL, you apply 5 volts, it can give only 3.6 volts maximum. And if you apply high, voltage does not become 0, it is less than 0.4. There is no 0 and 5 volt there. But here, since I am now taking analogy of a switch, there is a 0 and VDD. So that is the reason. So please forget all transistor characteristics of MOS, simply forget. But today, digital logic, just forget all characteristics. It is a good switch, you operate it as a switch, then we will understand millions of them, billions of them more easily. No burdening of transistor characteristics, which in great detail professor must have derived, right? All those square and all this. So how do you convert this inverter to a NAND gate? So what we have to do is, instead of one input, I need two inputs. So I now put, instead of this one transistor, I put two transistors in the lower half. If A is high and B is high, both these switches are on, and by definition these two transistors above should be off, and exactly opposite should happen. So now there is a dual. If you have got things in series in the lower half of the circuit, things should be parallel in the upper half of the circuit, because only one of them is supposed to be on, either the upper half or lower half. So now we can verify why this is parallel, this is series. So I leave it to you as an exercise, but this is the way it is. The algorithm is simple. If the lower half of the circuitry has got anything in series and parallel, when you go to the upper half of PMOS transistor, then it becomes exactly opposite. It is just like De Morgan's theorem, no? We do exactly that. So now is the lower half, upper half. Symbol remains same, truth table remains same. Now the MOS transistor is acting as switches. So this is a switch logic. There are no resistors, no voltages, no nothing. In the switch logic, we are quite happy with this kind of notation. Everything is connected and then symbol is like that. Now we want many inputs. Suppose I got a memory of 1 GB and then it requires 22 inputs for selecting the row and another 22 inputs for selecting the column. So, what will I do? I put 22 of these inputs. Happily A to Z allows up to 26, right. How many characters are there? No, but we are not teaching English here, though first standard mein ho gaya, does not matter. I can easily speak about A to X as 22 or 20. So, I can have A to X here. Now, I need 20 of these in series. Now, the question will come whether a switch is an ideal switch or it has got a resistance. If it has got a resistance, the resistance will keep on adding and become huge, and then it will not work as a good switch. So, it becomes a bad switch, and therefore, it is never used like this. So, this individual one is okay. Any one is shorted, it is good enough. More than one is shorted, it is bonus, but this is not acceptable. So, what we do is innovate. So, there are two innovations. One, just put a simple resistor. The resistor, let us say, is 10 kilo ohm, and this switch is 100 ohm or 10 ohm. Then 10 ohm versus 10 kilo ohm. So, we will get 1/100th of that voltage drop. So, V D upon 100 will become my low voltage, it will not be 0. When one is connected, it will be 1/100th of V D D. But when all of these are off, this resistor will bring the voltage there, full voltage. So, VDD is okay, but the lower voltage is no more 0, and therefore, we have to take that into account that it should not malfunction. The other one is a current source. The current source is put because invariably all these many devices have got a parasitic capacitance, and we got to charge that capacitance within picosecond, nanosecond, depending on the speed of your circuit. And therefore, nowadays everything is taken as a current source. So, a MOS transistor when it is in saturation is like a current source. MOS transistor when it is in the linear region is like a switch. These are the only two things you got to remember in the MOS transistor logic. In the saturation mode, it is like a constant current source. In the near the origin, it is a small resistor like a switch. And therefore, now I can get anything, any number of these. A NOR of any number of things is good enough. So, logic design using NOR. So, now we make a statement that any sum of product, you give me any function with a sum of products, I can always implement it using NORs, and that can be proved by De Morgan's theorem. So, I am not going to prove that, but suppose this is the exclusive OR function, A bar B plus A B bar. So, we do a double bar. So, without changing the function, the inside one we simplify and then we get this. This is just to prove that any sum of products can be converted to functions of NORs. So, I have now got this one NOR, and this becomes, so if this is called capital D and this is called capital E, then D plus E bar. So, that is another NOR. So, we get three NORs to do this. So, I have proved. This is called proof by induction. If something works for 1, something works for 2, then it will work for n. So, I already proved that any sum of product for 2, I get this. So, you can now verify any number of terms I have, I will still get this. So, there is no proof required. This is by induction, that this is always true, that any sum of product function can be implemented by NOR. So, now we grow big. So, if you have got functions of 3 variables, still it is true. Any sum of product of 3 variables also it is true. Any sum of product of 4 variables also. Any sum of products of 20 variables also it is true. So, that means all I need to do is make NORs. But how many NOR circuits will I do? How many NOR circuits will I make? For every row I have got this circuit, for every row, and there will be million rows and million columns, and I need millions of these NOR circuits. therefore, I require billions of transistors. Even to address the individual row and address the individual column in a memory, I require this thousands and thousands of gates. But if I have got a logic like this 7 segment display as an example, I write this 0, this is my 7 segment, the 0 will be 0000. So, as an example 1 is 0001, this is the binary equivalent of that. So, A bar, B bar, C bar, D, like that if you write, and if I take any particular function segment 1 occurs in 0, 1, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, you know this segment 1 is used in these functions, segment 7 is used in some other function, let us say, occurs in 0, 2, 3, 5, 6. Please find an error, no problem. Students are requested to find any error anytime, because I do not read books and copy from the books. All my notes, books are shut, I write from my memory, that is the best way, then I also make some mistakes. Over the years the student point of mistakes and I correct some of them, I leave some of them. Every year the students are supposed to find that mistake which madam found. Otherwise the mind is not alert. Every time professor says something is always right, then you do not have to listen, just read the notes, that is what you will think, that is what happens. And then I announce before exam that if there is any error intentional or otherwise in my notes, and if you put it in the exam, you will get 0 marks. Okay, that is no excuse. You cannot say, sir, your notes was having a wrong answer. You are supposed to correct it. I tell that in the class, but never correct the notes. So that works very well. So now we have this, say Y1 or Y7. So now what is this? Sum of 7 products with 4 variables. The 7 products can be called P1 to P7. How many products are there anyway with 4 variables? There are 16 products. P1 to P16, you can call it M0 to M15 or whatever. And then there is another implementation, and this is called PLA. So, anyway, do not worry about the exact location of this. The advantage of MO is another one, that they are self isolated, they work only as switch, all those were fine. If you draw anything like this circuit, you know the NOR circuit, one transistor, one transistor, one transistor, like that, their layout is exactly the same the way you draw it. And therefore, if this is the NOR gate with that current source here, if the NOR gate is going to work with ABCD, 4 transistors, their gates will be connected to appropriate one, and the output will go here P0 to how many? Up to P16, that is P0 to P15, the maximum 15 products. But in my particular circuit, I want only 7 of those, and then I will do this 7 of these. And without going into detail, I want to now implement the, say that is the NOR, the upper one is a NOR, and I want to implement NOR of that, NOR of this P0 to P15, because there are 7 segments, right. I must get an output for each one of them. So now I have got a set of equations, Boolean equations, Y1 some P0 to P7 or something, and Y2 etcetera to Ym. So, there is a subset here. So, there is a subset of all the possible combinations, right. But we may not have 15 because we have got only BCD, the 7 segment displays only for the BCD. So, we will have only 9. So, it does not matter. So, once we have this, this is called simultaneous equations of Boolean equations, and therefore, my inputs are 4, my outputs are 7. So, the OR is made for 7 such things. So, now you see here up, some of them are not even connected here. If only say P0, P1, P5 is not there, that P5 does not get connected, this gate remains open, and therefore, it is inactive. That does not act as a switch. So, exactly whatever is required is connected, and therefore, you now get the functions finally output as Y1 to Y7. So, I have got a perfect implementation of the set of Boolean equations. How many assumptions I have now said? If there is a sum of products, I can always implement by NOR. So, one set of NOR is inside and one bar. So, it happens that this creates that first P0 to P7, that is called the AND part, and this creates the NOR part. So, two together implement exactly that, and I have got exactly the function Y1 to Y7. Now, what is the programming? All these cells are here, the transistors. If P4 is not there in Y1, that P4 transistor is not connected. That means I should connect only those which are required, and therefore, this is called the AND OR programming. And this is called the programming. So, these ones are not connected, only these are programmed. So, the AND regions and OR regions are programmed by showing a dot there. Whichever terms are required, we show a dot that we require that term, and this is called therefore a programmable logic array. What does it do? It can program any set of equations. This m number can be anything, m can be even bigger than 100. So, there are many combinations of this digits that we can use. So, there are 7 outputs and there are 4 inputs, and then we can have this particular program. So, this is called a programmable logic array. Now, the generic thing is it is called programmable logic devices. Allows the full programming of all 0 to 15 terms, or it allows only a partial one. It depends on which one is full and which one is partial, but in general this is called PLDs, and they are made permanently. It is made by manufacturer. The programming is done by blowing a fuse there, or making that connection by breaking down a insulation, and that is done by programming. There is a machine for writing this thing in, and this become programmed. Now, they can be reprogrammed if it is a electrically erasable operation. So, EE program, so not the PROM, but EE. PROM is a programmable logic, and then it cannot be undone. So, it is a permanent. Then they were earlier this ultraviolet thing which can again reprogram, but now we have got electrically erasable. So, we can continuously write, and we can continuously modify it should you need that modification. So, the today's craze is what is called reconfigurable computing or system. So, continuously it can be reconfigured. On a command from elsewhere, I can reconfigure this by electrical means. So, this is the summary I have given. So, program the AND region, program the AND region for the input variable, N variable, outputs are P products. Out of the total possible 2^n products, I can only select P products, and then the output is programmed for m outputs depending on whatever the combination. So, they are generic programmable logic devices, field programmable, EEPROMs, and the most famous and most popular is the field programmable gate array. It all began with 10,000 gates, now it is, I do not know. Anybody latest number? What is the maximum number of gates? The last I heard of was 100k, so it must be definitely a million now. That many gates are available for you to do anything you want. What is done by this digital logic, including the flip flops? So, I have got these 3 applications, 2 of these are my own applications, and I will tell you why my applications are important. So, there is a stepper motor control. Once I wanted to actually control the temperature of a furnace, and I had to actually use a stepper motor to move the set knob, the temperature setting knob in a programmed way. Earlier I used to sit there myself, and the programming requires 20 hours. So, then I had to make all my friends sit there for 4 hours each. After 2 days I had no friends left, all become enemies. Apte is there, he is going to make me sit there for 4 hours. So finally, I was myself not my own friend. So how to do it, you know, day in and day out. So I said, I must make a electronic gadget. So I was not very fond of electronics in particular, but I had to make this gadget. So I made this gadget. I will only touch the essentials of this. As far as the, this is the diagram I like. Finally, I had to make a sequential machine. So depending on which tape it is, I must give a pulse to one of these four windings to go in the right direction. So I can select the direction and I can select the speed at which it moves. And therefore, I have to make what is called a state diagram. So if it is in the ABCD state and I get a direction pulse, then I must go into this. I get the direction pulse 0, I go into another state. So depending on direction, I must take the next operation. So this is a very common thing. So somebody will have already done it, or you will have done it yourself. So you have to pick up an application which is in good English and start implementing it by making this the diagram, state diagram. So you have to find how many states and then you make this. This requires to be transferred to electronics. So electronics require these four states in the circular, the numbers written across that are two digits. So to implement a four state machine, I require two flip flops, say E and F. And therefore, with two flip flops, we got this done, and then it was able to rotate plus minus, and then it will do this job. So this was the full diagram. This is what I made. So there was a clock, so 1 kilohertz or whatever, then I kept on dividing till I got 1 second. Then this become every 2 seconds, it become every 4 seconds, every 8 seconds, every 16 seconds, like that, all the way to hours. And then by selecting one of these, every 5 minutes, 1 hour, 2 hours, I was able to give fewer and fewer pulses. So as it becomes cooler and cooler, I go to here where pulse change every minute. And there are 200 pulses required to change it by one rotation, and one rotation was 20 degrees centigrade. So all was calculated, and I can select progressively the slowest one. As we become cooler, I wanted a exponentially going down cooling rate. And therefore, all this was done. Then there was a splitter logic, two flip flops, stepper motor received, and the stepper motor was actually monitored by using some optical scanner. Optical scanner is required because you cannot depend totally on a open control. This is called open-ended control. We will not know whether it is doing it or not, because what I wanted to do was put it on and go to sleep, put it on and come back tomorrow, put it on Friday evening 10 o'clock and come back on Monday morning, and this should have done that job. So, and I have to know that it has done the job. So it has to be logged in. So this is the nature of any application that you need. So what is the moral of this story? I will do any electronics if I am forced to do it. Necessity is the mother of learning. If there is no necessity, I will not learn. I will read a case study from a book and keep on repeating in the class. So there is another one, the actual numbers, what rate I wanted, at what temperature and all that. This is the way an application has to be done. Then this is an example just for the heck of it. So there is a lift and I want to count the number of people going in. So I must put two sensors, one laser which is shown red and one laser which is shown green, but both are infrared lasers or infrared LED and detector. So how do you detect a person going in? It must first operate X1 and then X2. So if this is the sequence of X1 and X2, then the person has gone in. So as soon as it is X1, it goes to a state diagram circle which says X1 has been detected. But if it again operates X1, then it comes out. It comes back to original state, nobody in the lift. Then again it goes like that. If it operates X2, then I put a counter up. So there is up down counter which is programmed. So every time X1 and X2 are operating in that order, my counter goes up. 1 person in, 10 persons in. After 8 persons, it will give an alarm. if that is the capacitor. Yes, please. No. These are all hypothetical problems for students. So we don't do any such thing. This is not a real case. It's just for understanding. So we have this case that the person comes out, then he operates X2 first and X1 next, and then it should count down. So this was an exercise to students, just to make a up down counter. I think you have got an exercise tomorrow. Then you will say, why are we doing this experiment up down counter? The same counter, why sometimes counting up, sometimes counting down? Professor wants us to trouble. This is where it is required. That is the way it is. This is the state diagram. As soon as we get X2, then it says, oh, I am likely to have a person going out, etcetera, etcetera. But I am here, nobody is inside, and then it starts all over and then keeps going up and down. So this is the diagram, and then we require 5 states, therefore I require 3 flip-flops. That is the way it is counted. 2^n, n being the number of flip-flops. So number of states in the diagram are 8, then I require 3 flip-flops. Anything more than that, I require the next. So the flip-flop number does not increase that fast. Number of states go as 2^n. Then you do this. This is that logical implementation. The flip-flops and these counters and all this. This is the output of the flip-flop 1, output of flip-flop 2. If that none is not a condition, then we can even do with the 2 flip-flops. Because none is very easy. As you wake up, it can wake up with a 0. You do not have to have that as a state. And therefore, 2 flip-flops will do it. So this is the way an application has to be created to get the student interested. Otherwise, you can give a standard for formula or problem that do this up and down counter. So I think I have done what was needed. The journey to go from logic inverter to a VLSI logic, the simple truth is, all we have to think of a MOS transistor is a switch in the, and the logic has to work with the switches as a concept. Only when we want 20 inputs and so on, we found that the linear connection of 20 odd transistors is not desirable, then we connect a current source, because the MOS transistor in saturation is acting as a current source. So now with these 2 ideas, now we are able to do all programmable logic. What is the difference between PLD and sequential machines? PLD is operating on the state of inputs as of that time. It does not depend on what is previously done. Whatever is at that time, the combinatorial logic will only give an output. But in real applications, we have to know what was the history also. Like how many people were already inside the lift, that we have to know. So like that history, we have to know the history, and therefore memory units are required, and the flip-flops are those units. So if you now make sequential circuits, we can now make the applications. So FPGA has this capability of, you know, connecting themselves as flip-flops, connecting themselves as combinatorial logic, connecting themselves as you know, the adders, subtractors, multipliers. So all arithmetic logic, etcetera, etcetera. So whatever are the building blocks of a microprocessor or any real application, the FPGA has got regions in which these are pre-programmed and available for users to use, and therefore it becomes very easy to program an application on FPGA. So now for the last one, there are of course students who are coming after experience of 4-5 years and doing PhD here, and so there is a story about a particular professor, very sincere fellow, very silent, very likable, but his colleagues were not very happy. The colleagues asked him once, how come you define the problem for the student, then you solve it, finally you even write his thesis, I mean what is this? Don't you get irritated that you have to define the problem, solve the problem and also write the thesis, PhD thesis? He said it's okay. He said no, but you must be irritated sometime. He said yes, when they come and ask for the progress. Kitna hua thesis. So that's the worst part of any professor's mind, that get a student, for him he has to do all three, and on top of it he will keep coming time to time and ask what is the progress. So I think short of that, it is a pleasure to be talking to you, and I guess I have taken you to the journey from an inverter to a VLSI. As I say, it is not my objective to teach you, you have more experience, but I think in every field or every topic you go to analog like that, so first concept to the students should be that overview, that how everything gets connected. You can tell in the beginning and then in the end. So there is another one which is a cliche for you, that you tell them what you are going to tell them by overview like this, then you tell them in detail, and in the end you tell them what you have told them. The third time they will understand. So you must not ever actually in the end hurry up and say, I have to cover more topics, I have to cover more topics, you know, in a hurry you finish chunks of thing in the end. Your job is to uncover the topic, not cover the topic. For the student you have to uncover the topic, so that means you have to set a pace which leaves you 5 lectures in the end without anything to be done. And what is that 5 lectures for? Is to give them that final one, that what I have told you, I am telling you again. So third time you are lucky, they will understand, because as I said, they are like a baby, start standing up, walking, running. Only when they start running they perfect the previous stages, and therefore in the end you have to tell them again what you have told them. And for that you must not leave anything to chance, you must cover all your topics 4 lectures before the end, so that you can uncover lot of learning, and that is the purpose. But unfortunately the syllabi of university is so cramped with knowledge, 2 courses being squeezed into one and so on. But I still attempt. I think even a student, I assume that you can appreciate, even a student in such overview lecture will understand something. He may not actually do everything, but then that is why the tutorial is absolute must. Without tutorial a course is going to be flat. You tell them, they forget. The tutorial is the one where they actually remember. And a project, a real project with a purpose, it may be a hypothetical project like counting people in a lift, but a project that hypothetical also will tell them why they have to count up and down. So like that, every laboratory exercise must have a English story why they are doing it. I think we do not have that here. We should. An example of why somebody wants to count something up and down, that story has to be there. Why you have to take the characteristics of a transistor, that story has to be there. You have to say that this characteristic is important for this reason. So in MOS, what is the important thing? The straight line portion and the saturation portion, nothing else is important, that you have to tell them. Any questions, by the way? I conduct many courses, 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, 5 day for industries. The most important thing is to finish on time, with time for questions. When do we not finish on time and leave no time for questions? When we are afraid that we cannot answer any questions. Then you must take more time, so that the audience is so tired and wanting to have a cup of tea so badly, they will not ask any questions. So I think we have few minutes still left, 11 o'clock, right? Questions? I have those 6 lectures I told you, one on inverter to VLSI logic, other one is RLC analysis to VLSI analysis, and then LED to lasers, and two of my other favorite topics is what is innovation for students and what is design of experiment for experimenters. The last one for all you people, I will write, I have not written yet, 1.5 hour overview of how you can get results which are publishable and will get lot of citations, how to plan research which will get you very good papers which get cited.
Sir, my question is related to VLSI.
Okay.
It's about pass transistors. We say that we should not connect more than 4 pass transistors in series.
Yes.
Can you throw some light upon that, sir?
For the same good reason we had this 20 or series transistors, and their resistances will add. So we should not.
Why exactly 4? I mean, why not 5 transistors?
Now, this all depends on detailed specification. And my answer will flabbergast you to no end. This is my knowledge I had in 1984. After that, I am not doing VLSI. But VLSI has not moved too much. 25 years ho gaya, toh kuch zyada aage nahi gaya hai. What I am saying is the principle, basic principles remain same. The specifications, why 4? Because now we are going from 5 volts to 3 volts to 2 volts, and now the future VLSI will work at 1 volt, then they reduce that limit to 2. But depends on what voltage you have access to and what is the noise margin you have got to define a 0 and 1. As the voltages are going down, so the number of series transistors will go down. In my time, we used to say not more than 8 with 5 volt supplies. But now that number has to go down, because otherwise you will encroach on the noise margin. So 0 will not be recognized as 0, it will become 1, etc. But concept is same, that too much of resistance will come and voltage drop will appear. Any other question? But I am not a VLSI man, I left it in 1984, but it is okay. The general knowledge remains same. That is a good part of it. So, after all, what does the professor teach? Whatever the syllabus, this is one of our old professors used to say, professor teaches what he knows, finally. He does not teach as per the syllabus, he only teaches what he knows. So, I think as a basic funda, as a happily first year to a second year courses, there is no problem at all. Not only it is good if you teach them what you know, it is appropriate that you only teach them what you know. When you teach them in third and fourth year, you have to read more recent work and then prepare yourself with information. See, the fourth year courses are more informative, less knowledge and less wisdom. This is the way it goes: data, information, knowledge and wisdom. As you go to the fourth year, it becomes only information. But they need the information. So, the how are they doing the current mobile networking and all that? This is the information. So, what is 2G? What is the difference between 2G and 3G spectrum? That is the information. Sorry, I do not know, but people who teach will have to know, they will have to learn. So, with that I think we will end. Thank you very much.